Hi, Chris here. Comparing apples to oranges, the orange being an MSI GE 66 Raider. Now, this one is the 11UH model that has an RTX 3080, a Core i7 11800H. Up against now the new MacBook 16 2021 edition, with, of course, the Apple Silicon, the M1 Pro, which has 10 cores and 16 GPU cores. So what I'll do is do a bit of a general kind of comparison with some benchmarks, but I do want to focus on video editing performance and export times in this video to see just how much faster or slower will the MacBook here be, and how does it fare in editing video versus what I normally edit video on, which is this model right here with its 4K OLED screen. And then the other differences here. So weight-wise, the MacBook is a lot heavier than I thought it would be. So this is 2.14 kilos versus 2.37 for the MSI with that dedicated graphics. And of course, with the PC, we have Type A ports, which is really good. I can just plug in a mouse or something there. Type C port here is a USB 3 spec, and then we've got the Thunderbolt. So three Thunderbolt ports on the MacBook. Now, each one of them has its own bus, so each one of them is 40 gigabits per second transfers, 3.5 millimeter headphone jack, and MagSafe is back. Although the magnet on this one seems to be way stronger than what I remember on previous generations. Maybe it's just me. Even does have a SD card slot, which is great. Now, it's not as fast as the one I have, which is SD Express. This one can do up to 980 megabytes per second reads from this MSI G66. The two Type A USB ports there as well, great. And just sadly, HDMI 2.0 from the MacBook Pro here. That's really disappointing. Why is this not HDMI 2.1? That's a bit of an odd decision too. However, of course, with the Thunderbolt, I can use Thunderbolt Type C to then DisplayPort 1.4 and run up to 8K 30. The GE66 Raider does have HDMI 2.1, 2.5 gigabit LAN, and a Thunderbolt 4 port, but only one of them with this DisplayPort there. So ports, of course, on the PCs, especially gaming laptops, you normally do get a lot more. Now, briefly looking at our display, so very different, of course, these two machines here. But we got with the MacBook the best screen because it's got 120 hertz and the brightness is just crazy. It tops out at 1600 nits. Now, the laptop that I've got here, that MSI, the GE Raider 66, it's a 4K screen, 60 hertz. But it's actually a very good screen because it is a OLED screen. That's one of the reasons I got this laptop, for color grading, editing videos and things, and just overall, I just love OLEDs. MacBook Pro 16 here does have a 90% Adobe RGB color coverage here and 100% sRGB. And then the 4K OLED that's in the GE66 Raider here, 100% Adobe RGB. It also has 100% sRGB, 97% NTSC, and P3 is 94%. So better color coverage and gamut than what we have in that MacBook. Now, the brightness on this screen tops out at just over 800 nits, so it's a really good screen for a gaming laptop. However, both of them are, of course, super reflective. Now, the 120 hertz means that everything's really smooth. That's what I'm missing out with the MSI gaming laptop there, is it does not go over 60 hertz, which is a real shame. 90 hertz with a 4K OLED like that would have been, I think, the sweet spot there and perfect. Now up here, of course, that notch, it's relatively hidden at the moment because I'm using a dark theme, dark mode at the moment, but it's the most dumbest thing ever that I have seen in tech recently, is that eyesore notch. It doesn't even have Face ID, so why do they even bother? It's a 1080p camera. And I've also got a 1080p camera in my MSI, but yes, the quality of the MacBook camera is better. And just briefly here, the touchpad and the keyboard, I'd have to give the win there to the MacBook. That's overall, it's better. The touchpad is just ridiculously large, but once you get used to it, it is probably the best touchpad that you can find in a laptop. And then with our MSI here, RGB keyboard, I don't mind it. It's a SteelSeries keyboard, which I think for a gaming laptop is not a bad keyboard at all. And our touchpad, well, that's not exactly that great here. The touchpad I do find to be a little on the small side, and not amazing. And you'll see the RGB strip here, that's giving me a few extra frames per second. Let's get onto a little bit of general performance too. So this is Geekbench 5. So this Score single core here for the Core i7-11800H is not bad at all, and multi-core score getting up towards 10,000 points. However, look at this MacBook Pro 16 with the M1 Pro. It absolutely smashes it. Not only is it using less wattage here, but that 10-core M1 Pro gets a much better single-core score here. That is an amazing score, really. And then the multi-core score there, look at that, 12,000 points. That's a big step up. And the best thing for me is that the fan noise on the MacBook Pro is basically non-existent. It's so quiet. I can't hear it most of the time. The fans are off even running this benchmark. This was run on the battery too. So if I'd run it on just the battery with my GE66 Raider here, it would not have got the score I just showed you before. So really impressive results here. Now here is where the MacBook Pro is a little bit weaker, of course, in the GPU department. So I don't have the M1 Max, which would be a lot better with its 32 cores. This has 16 cores. The OpenCL score here for Geekbench 5 is nearing 40,000 points. But of course, that RTX 3080 at 140 watts, I believe it is with this model, is, wow, look at that. It's just destroying the M1 Pro's GPU there with, over 100,000 points more for this OpenCL test. 3DMark's Wildlife shows that it gets 26,000 points. And then just over 10,000 points here with a MacBook Pro 16. Now, I would love to run something like Firestrike or Night Raid, but unfortunately, it doesn't seem to be supported yet with the Mac and Apple Silicon. The internal storage speed. So my MacBook Pro here does have 16 gigabytes of RAM and the 512 gigabyte SSD. So if I did have a 1 terabyte version or 2 terabyte version, then these speeds here would, of course, be a lot better. So it's around reading at about 5,000 megabytes per second, whereas the PCIe 4 Samsung 980 Pro of my MSI pushes close to 7,000 points. Now, this is on the battery I ran this one here, so it could actually do a little bit better than this. It's a 1 terabyte version. Cinebench now. So with the Core i7, the 11800H, I was able to achieve just under 12,000 points. Now the best scores I have seen, if I did undervolt and overclock this particular 8-core 16-thread chip, I could actually get it up in the 14,000 point mark there. But I haven't done that in this video. I've just run it stock here, okay? And that was after 10 minutes. It did end up throttling down a little bit, and the fans were relatively loud, mid kind of RPMs on the CPU. And then now our MacBook score getting over 12,000 points, beating out that Core i7-11800H. That's impressive. Now this was on the battery too as well, so it will go for 10 minutes and the score doesn't really seem to drop down either very much, only by about maybe 100 or 200 points, so it barely throttles. And the amazing part is the fan noise again, that it literally makes no noise. It's whisper quiet. I can't hear it. It's just so quiet. And now the real test that I wanted to do is video editing with the MacBook Pro 16 with the M1 Pro and the 16 gigabytes of RAM, 512 gigabytes of storage, up against what is currently what I'm using for editing a video right here. This is my Vivo X70 Pro Plus review. Recently posted that one in the channel. So exactly the same project is open on both of these machines at the same time. So we do have the Apple Silicon version here of Adobe Premiere Pro, latest version on both of these machines. And I've noticed straight away that it may, in the beginning, load up a little bit faster, but when it comes in, everything, all the files, it's definitely quicker on the MacBook. The MacBook seems a lot faster. The playback too, I've noticed in the timeline. Let's take a look at that. Okay, timeline on the PC here with a half playback resolution. With a very long video as this, but quite a very simple, basic edit, it's very quick. It's not bad. The RTX, with its Q2 cores, RTX 3080, handling this really well. Now, I've noticed that sometimes it can slow down a little bit, occasionally might drop a few frames, but with the dedicated graphics, this performance is very good. Now, if I didn't have dedicated graphics, if it was just running off, say, Iris Xe graphics, it would not be performing so good. So with a basic edit here, it's okay, but when I start to layer it on, like my camera comparisons, and I put a couple of 8K clips in there too, it sometimes gets a little slow. Now with the MacBook, it does seem that everything's a little bit smoother, but you might have picked up on this. There's something really weird going on with the colors right here, and I don't know why that is, because I have not color graded this or changed it, but it seems like the gamma's completely gone on my clips. It seems to be a bug. It was not doing that before, because when I go through and take a look at this, like, that's not meant to be colored like that. That's just horrible. Like, I've come out all yellow and overblown. I don't know what is going on. So some sort of glitch or bug has just appeared there. But the general performance, like the timeline again, is very good, really smooth here. And I would have to say, for editing, I've done just a couple of test edits now on the MacBook, that it does seem overall in general to be a little more smoother than my experience with even an RTX 3080. And I just think it's because of the playback of the H.264 and H.265 files tend to be smoother on the M1 Pro. But now I wanted to check on, of course, the export times. I have noticed that it is definitely faster with the CUDA cores, NVIDIA RTX 3080, a lot of power there with the GPU, but a more powerful CPU with that M1 Pro. So what is the difference going to be? I've got my little timer here. So I'm about to hit export. I'll do it on both of these at the same time, but obviously the time I need to start first, because I only have two hands, not three of them. So I've got both of them set to the 4K preset here, okay, that it's exporting out to, the 4K YouTube preset that is. So export, that's lined up right there with our mouse, export and export. And just about a second later, I'll hit that too as well. So let's go export on both. Okay, and start that timer. On the PC, 74% on our CPU and 91% on the RTX 3080, which is currently 71 degrees hot. We can see here on the Mac that Adobe there is using a lot of CPU. In fact, that's 145%, GPU is 85%. All right, so the PC is finishing up. The status bar there's still at 100%, so it hasn't actually finished the whole file yet. 7 minutes and 13 seconds, there we go. Approximately 7 minutes and 15 seconds, you could say. And the MacBook is about to finish up. Let's have a look what it is going to be, the final result here. There we go, about 10 minutes and 42 seconds versus the 7 minutes and 15 seconds on my PC with the Core i7-11800H and that RTX 3080. So that is a big difference there, but what is a huge difference is the fan noise, just how quiet this MacBook is. Now there's one area that any powerful gaming laptop is just not going to be able to compete at all, even though this has a 99 watt hour battery. Now I can put it, take it off the MUX switch mode, which is dedicated graphics only at the moment, to use then the integrated graphics. I could maybe squeeze 3 hours of battery life out of this. This thing can get 10 hours more. Yes, I didn't make a mistake, 10 hours more. I've been able to get over 10 hours battery life on this so far with still battery remaining, so you can make it through a whole day. It is incredible how this just sips away. It doesn't consume a lot of energy at all, and that is why there is basically, for most tasks that people will be doing, any light computing, the fan never comes on. And I'm really shocked to see it will take at least about 5 minutes or 4 minutes or so of video encoding, that's loading up that CPU to the absolute max, before the fan comes on. And then seriously, you struggle to hear it. This, for me, has completely blown me away. I'm used to gaming laptops and even the Ultrabooks that I have and I review. The fans are still going to come on with the heavy workloads. It's normal. It's a hot part, but this does not generate that heat. So fan noise is just fantastic. It's amazing. The battery life, touchpad, excellent, very good. Keyboard, I think it's decent, but I'm still getting used to some of the things that Apple has with the differences in the layout coming from Windows. So the gaming laptop, of course, it's so obvious. For games, you're a gamer, this is what you go for. But if you just work and edit videos, or you're using something like Lightroom and Adobe Photoshop and things like that, this is the way to go for just work only, because of the battery life, the build quality, the screen, the performance. And yes, that notch is just, I think, one of the most stupidest decisions I've ever seen of what is a very, very good display. The brightness on this is impressive, and 120 hertz is great too with that screen. Not to say that this is a bad screen too that I have. As I showed you, it actually has better color coverage than the Retina screen here. This one being the OLED. That's one of the main reasons why I went for this particular gaming laptop, because it has a fantastic screen for a gaming laptop. 4K, this is not 4K. We've got the proper 16:9 aspect ratio for the videos I edit. 4K, if I reduce the scaling, can give me a huge amount of screen space to work with too there, of course, with this model. So you've got the three Thunderbolt 4 ports, only one on this. SD card reader on this is faster. The 2.5 gigabit LAN port. It's, you know, there's a lot of differences between them, and especially the price. So this is 2.7 thousand euros here in Spain. That's a lot of money for half the storage of what this has. It has a 16 gigabytes of RAM. This also does too. But I've got that RTX 3080, which is super powerful, that does come with this for the gaming and everything. And this model here cost me 2,100 euros with the 4K OLED screen. So a 600 euro difference. I know they're completely different beasts here. Very different machines. As I said in the start, we are comparing here definitely apples to oranges. So thank you so much for watching my little comparison here. I hope you did like it. Do subscribe for more, and I'll see you hopefully back in the channel in the next video.